I welcome you all, and it's wonderful to see all these new faces. So I was asked to contribute three lectures to tackle the history of art of the Arab world. That's my area. Clearly, there is in our region, it's very important to include Iran and Turkey generally and neighboring countries. But my specialty is in the Arab world. So for now, for this evening, I will be approaching the history in a different way. So not chronologically necessarily, but also looking mostly at the roots of portraiture in the region. And when we say roots, we're going back into ancient history to the present. Last year, someone asked me, why portraiture? Why the subject to introduce history of the region? My answer was, why not? I mean, portraiture has been practiced since ancient times, and it would be interesting to see why people practiced the art of portraiture way back from the pharaonic period and through the ages. And clearly for different reasons, using different media, different methods, and it reflects actually the art, the practice of that period. And therefore, that's why we chose that. We could equally select another topic like landscape, which would be our next topic. And there are civilizations or countries in the most recent times that have focused on one area more than the other. For example, Lebanon is known for its portraiture as well as landscape, and so was Syria because they were one region prior to the partitioning of the region. We see also there is some portraiture in Turkey, a great deal, particularly of the royal families in Egypt as well, and in the wealthy patrons of the art in Alexandria. So we have a legacy of portraiture, and the landscape follows that pattern as well. But it gives us a different view of how art was practiced across times in different by different people. I have to navigate two computers here, plus a microphone, and a tape recorder in my pocket. So excuse me if I get a little bit confused where I am. So, yes, this is an image taken. I can't see the year it was painted. Omar, but it's the Lebanese artist Omar Unsi, and I always, when I present on portraiture and painting, I love this image. And it's an image of a Lebanese woman, clearly conservative, who are looking at the details and wondering and aghast at the nudity featured in this painting. And their children are look kind of, there is a bored kid here trying to, reaching out to his mother to just had enough of this, but it doesn't seem the women are really engaged with this painting. And I believe this is from the 1930s in Lebanon. So I will have to check again because I just put it here as an intro, basically. So the tradition of portraiture extends back, as I said, to antiquities and to the pharaonic period, and clearly to the Greco-Roman period as well. With a few exceptions, artists created these magnificent sculptures, and here is one of them, during the pharaonic period, for a reason. So basically, some of these sculptures, and here is a sculpture of the seated scribe. It's a very famous sculpture from the year 2400 BC. And during the pharaonic period, clearly. And this same scribe was also a painter. So he's one of those that we know very few names are of painters or artists of that period, clearly, because they didn't sign their work but references to them were made in later documentation, and so there are a few that are known to us today. And the scribe is considered to be one of them. These images, whether realistic like the scribe, or other that are more idealized, like these two sculptures from, I believe, the fourth dynasty, Pharaonic dynasty, these are more clearly idealized than the other ones. And both were practiced. Clearly with the royal families or the pharaohs themselves, their images were more idealized for most of the period, but not every period. So we could see some of the pharaohs who had a more realistic images than others. So here is a Cleopatra image and the image of another lady, with not exactly who she is, but I chose that example because I thought it was a magnificent representation, and it's a more realistic, while the one on your right is a more idealized version of the portrait. So whoever could afford to commission an artist to create an image of themselves did so, because the image of self, whether in sculpture or painted on the coffins when very close to the mummified bodies, meant an extension of life after death. And that was part of their belief, clearly, at that time. And therefore, we do see images, and we'll see them later, of average people who could, or middle class, if we might say, who afforded to have that, or the deities and the pharaohs of that period. Here is another example also in sculpture. So basically, these people believe they were immortalized after death through their images in painting and sculpture. And the color was also significant during that period, because we note that generally, and these colors have changed through time, but they believe that the yellow was used in the portraying woman, and the color, the men were portrayed in more ochre or red color. So it is hard to verify that. I tried to verify that looking at these images some time ago, but it's not clear how they came to this conclusion. But it's generally believed that these were specific colors used for different genders. The changes that we see with the styles of painting came influenced by the Greco-Roman period, which we can see now here in these images from the, which we'll see later actually with the Fayum portraits. But I would like to go back to what's happening during that period or close to it in the Arabian Peninsula. And 2 years ago, there was an amazing exhibition called The Roads to Arabia that opened at the Louvre in Paris and traveled across several continents, as I think is still traveling, that showed for the first time archaeological and ancient art from Saudi Arabia. And for many of these objects were never exhibited in Saudi Arabia before. They were exhibited in Paris. And that's really interesting to know, as they may have been in archaeological museums but in storage, but they haven't been on exhibit. And therefore, there is a change now in the policy, and it seems that the new museums will be including these objects. And we see here on the right a mask. This is a golden mask from Tell el-Zayer in Saudi Arabia. And this is another sculpture. And, you know, what is striking is the features. The features are, we don't see, like in Egypt, for different dynasties, they try to have similar features for a few of the pharaohs. They adopted this practice of an artist would copy features. For example, if it's in the same family, that the dead child would have the features of their father for their Fayum portraits, for example, at some point. But later on, we will see the Fayum portrait became very unique to each dead or mummified body. Here is another example from the Arabian Peninsula as well. And it's a head of a man from Saudi Arabia in the 3rd century BC to the 2nd, from that period at least. I think it's a very interesting feature of the nose. It's almost like a distorted face. So keep that image in mind as we move forward in time with these other images. This is a fragment also found in the Arabian Peninsula in the 1st century. And it's interesting when we look at the eyes and the portrayal of the facial features, how close is it to the Greco-Roman style of painting. And you see this style also in the icon paintings of later periods in the Syrian or the Aleppo Church, Syrian Orthodox icons, or the Greek Orthodox and Russian icons. There is this kind of Byzantine style of painting in that. And you can see the red here again, but it's because they happened to use natural dyes, and that's what was available. And here we go back to the Fayum portrait I mentioned earlier, and Fayum is in reference to a region in Egypt, Fayum Basin in Egypt. And clearly, this was a period in Egyptian history where the Greco-Roman had influenced the art of that period. And these, the public are not necessarily, they're a mix, a multiracial a group of people here we have influence. Clearly there is the Greek influence, but also the Roman period influence at this time. And we see that this is these images are and facial features are unique to each deceased, and they are actually painted on the wood. Yes, exactly. So that is meant to be there because it is not clear what it references, but it is written in Greek. And that's the language used at that time, in that period. So this is a very famous, maybe many of you have seen the picture of a young man. And again, it's painted on encrusted wood. It is an amazing likeness, probably, to the deceased. But the typical use of these round, bright eyes, and you can practically see the light shining at the pupils, and an amazing rendition of this young man. You can even see the hairstyle. He must have kept his hair well-styled. So it these kind of features, it is also what the artist sees in the person. So it's not a matter of taking a picture of that deceased, and as we do now, but it's rather an artist who is also trying to emphasize what is the inner nature of that person is, as they believed in that time. And there's another example from that same period and style, and there is a, and we can see here how close these features of the eyes and the way they're painted, the roundness of the eyes, and the oval face is typical of many of these painted features. Here is another image that I thought was very interesting from the Nabatean period in the Arabian Peninsula. And again, this is a kingdom, the Nabatean kingdom is well known. It was flourished on the trade in the region. And it's one of the they had facial, the profile of the king and the queen on their on the coin here, which I thought was, that's 9 BC to 40 AD during the Nabatean kingdom rule of Aretas IV and his wife Shugalit. And I find it very interesting that even at that time, the male and female were equally represented on the nation's coins, and compared to what we represent at this time on our monetary paper or coins. I brought this example from the Sasanian period just to show the resemblance between these and the Greco-Roman and mosaics as well. And that did influence the later the Umayyad frescoes that we will see here an example of. So Sasanian period is ruled mostly in the Iranian or Persian empires, and they have a beautiful examples of works in all kinds of medium. And here is another example from the Umayyad, so yes, from Qasr al-Amra in Jordan, in what is now Jordan. And it's interesting to see the figure of a nude woman also in these Umayyad palaces, in the desert palaces in Jordan. There are several exquisite examples of these frescoes that has been conserved recently. So we see this example, but we also, there is an example here also of portraits of two women from the Abbasid period, from Samarra in Iraq. Again, there is a great deal to explore here. I'm just giving you these as in examples because we want to spend more time on the modern and the contemporary period in exploring each artwork and the artist's oeuvre and all that. But for now, I mean, it's clearly you can see that later on there are, of course, examples such as the Alwasiti from the 12th century also from Iraq. And this is a portrait of a young man from the Abbas Fatimite period, Khalif al-Hasim, Hakim. The writing here is looking very small. I don't know why. So these are examples of portraits. And the reason I included them, because even in the contemporary art now, we find that artists have been inspired by these. We may not have to have replicas of them, and there is not a direct inspiration. So it takes a real in-depth study of where of the artist's work to identify many of these influences, whether from the pharaonic period or later periods, or the use of color, or the use of the dyes, or the medium. And that you can see in the works of artists like Dia al-Azawi and others. From Iraq, Dia actually himself was an archaeologist, so he was definitely impressed by what he saw at the archaeology museum in Baghdad. Equally, what we need to understand is the context the modern and contemporary artists worked in. So if we talk about artists who started painting in the mid-19th century, we also know that someone like Dawood Qurm, for example, a Lebanese artist who was born, I believe, in 1852. So Dawood Qurm was born in Lebanon in 1852, and he started painting at a very young age of 14. He painted actually portraits for his families and friends, and the priest at his school noticed his talent, and they eventually gave him private lessons because then he started selling his artwork and made enough money to go and study in Italy. And in Italy, it is known that he actually painted the Pope at that time, and came back to Egypt, to Lebanon, and painted many of the Maronite priests in his village. He later on, I think at the 1900, early 1900s, opened a sort of like a stationery store next to the post office in downtown Beirut to sell art supplies. So that's the context I'm telling you about earlier, is that we need to study what context these artists were working in. So he was unique and clearly in his artwork and his abilities, but there were other artists as well at that time. So because he did have a successful business running that selling art supplies, and that's in downtown Beirut. So that tells us that there were many other artists as well. We don't have, there hasn't been enough art historical research in each Arab country to say for certain who was, for example, the first. And that was a question asked earlier today. But I say it is not as important who was first as much as what environment they were working in. And it's sometimes very difficult to identify, or why do we need to know if one artist painted a year earlier than the other one? Overall, what's important is to, as I said, study the context they were working in and the purpose of their art as well. So here's a self-portrait by Dawood Qorm. And Dawood Qorm, his great-granddaughter, I think, is doing research on him. And there has been several monographs and catalogs on his life and art. So he has been fairly well studied compared to other artists. Other examples of early painters is the Syrian artist Tawfiq Tariq. Actually, and he was born in 1875, and as you can see, the clearly this is a prominent person that has commissioned his own painting, probably, or someone else may have done it. He's a dervish, and you can see the medals. Actually, what's interesting about this painting is the medals and the flags on these medals. And that is worth investigating further. And so we don't have enough research done on these paintings, that are many of which are now in the auction houses. So we really, and so remember, when these paintings go into the auction houses, then we lose also track of where, you know, their history, and it becomes even more difficult to do research about them. And that I can go back and elaborate on if you're interested later on. Now, Rassami is Iraqi, and this is a fantastic example of his work. You can see that is definitely his artwork is quite developed. The title of the work is a portrait of Muhammad al-Alusi from 1924. So this is oil on canvas. So oil on canvas was available in Iraq in the 1920s. Actually, in the 1930s, the Iraqi government granted a scholarship, a full scholarship, to Madiha Omar to study art in London. So that is not that far back. George Sabbag is another example. There was an exhibit for him not long ago at the American University of Beirut, and he was born again in the late 19th century, and he was known for his portrait paintings. So most of these artists I'm mentioning here are known more for their portraits than landscape. George Unsi, that you, I started the lecture with his painting of the woman gazing at the naked painting. He has many, many more works on landscape than these. But apparently, the reason there are so many also portraits is that it's a form of the artist can make a living out of these portraits. And it was very popular at that time for wealthy people to commission these artists all over the region. So we find examples of these in, as I said earlier, in many cities. there are also portraits of anonymous people, such as peasants. Peasants was a very popular subject of portraiture in Egypt in particular, and at some point in Iraq as well. But you see that this came in later. Another example is by Atta Saber from Iraq. And these are excellent examples because you don't see them at auction houses, and you will not, I doubt if there will be other examples. These two from Iraq, this one and the previous one, are from in the collection of in Madhaf in Doha, Qatar. Another excellent example of a sculptor early from 1958 is Jamal Siri, and we have here a sculpture of the famous poet Ahmed Shawqi from 1958. But prior to that, we all are familiar with Mahmoud Mukhtar. I'm sorry, I don't have the caption here, but this is the sculpture, the famous sculpture from Mahmoud Mukhtar in Egypt. And these are all background information for you, but I cannot go into detail. There's not enough time to go into detail into everyone. But last time I gave this lecture or similar lecture last time, I was asked to show more images. And I try to focus on a few artists and go more in depth later on, maybe this evening. Also, we have to remember that during that period, there were artists who were commissioned by the church to paint icons in Syria in particular. So many believe that the icon painting came from Greece. Well, Greece has an influence, in, as I said earlier. But there are many artists, some of them not Christian, who were commissioned by the church to paint these icons. This is an excellent example, which I actually got from the church in, God knows what's happened to it now with the conflict in Syria. It's an amazing piece and still in the collection of the Church of the Sand Cross in Damascus. This is Ahmed Osman, and the head of an Egyptian peasant. As I said earlier, the artists were not just painting portraits for the wealthy. They also did these beautiful portraits of the peasants. And the peasants represented to the artist their identity and nationhood. Because many might remember from history the peasant revolution in Egypt in 1917. That was an important historical date for at the end of the World War II and during the British rule over Egypt. The peasant revolution was very important, and at times some people recently have been comparing it to the Arab Spring. So the peasant was not looked down upon, as we think, as working in for hardly any wages. You know, peasants were exploited by the feudal system practically in Egypt. But the artists, many of them, have idealized the peasants, and the peasant woman represents nationhood in many and motherland in many of the paintings of Egyptian artists, from Mohammed Nagy's famous mural to other artists later on during the Egyptian revolution in 1952 and in the 50s. So that's I included only one example, but there are many other portraits. Also, Western artists visiting Egypt have painted. This was the image of the peasant, Egyptian peasant woman, who is very popular among the European artists who lived in Alexandria at that time. Many of them were living in Egypt, in Cairo. I chose this one for Adam Wenley from 1955. And you may have seen some examples of his work at auctions recently and at the art fair. But this one would not come up, so I thought I will, because it is in the collection of El Madhaf. Ramses Yunan, here's this is known as one of the abstract artists, the first abstract artist of Egypt. And this work is in from the 1942. He was a member of the Art and Liberty Group, which we're known now for the as a surrealist group in Egypt. And they have written, he's one of those who signed the manifesto against the fascist rule in Germany and in support of the artists in Germany and France. Later on, he and the group, several members of this group, like Adam Hunain and Telmasani and others, went to France and to meet André Breton, who was, as you know, the art critic and leader in surrealist movement in France. And they found out that they had a fundraiser for the State of Israel. There was an art auction to raise funds for the establishment of the State of Israel. Of course, they were disenchanted by this, and the group sort of dismantled after the, not necessarily because of that, but there might be other reasons as well, which I'm not sure of. But eventually, this is a short period, I would say, of about 20 years from in the 1940s and up to the mid-50s, possibly, of the height of the surrealist production in Egypt by several artists. And so you can see that elements in this work already. Another artist who from this period who have produced a huge number of portraits in her 80s, when she was in her 70s and 80s, actually, is Princess Fakhrinisa Zeyd, who was born in Istanbul and she was actually known as a Turkish artist and was a member of the Dada group in Istanbul until her she got married to her second husband, who was a Jordanian Hashemite family and was an ambassador. So she traveled with him, lived in Paris and Berlin, and exhibited her work there as well. And finally, she took residence in Amman, Jordan, where she taught art to a group of women who later became well-known artists, such as Suha Shuman and Princess Wujdan Ali and others. There was a group of 5 to 6 of them. She lived until the age of almost 92, and she died in Jordan, and now she leaves a legacy of a huge collection of her artwork that's gone up in price recently. This is a self-portrait by the artist, and it's quite something. This was done in 1940s, and this was in the 1981 of her and her son, and it's called a very interesting Divine Protection. Her son Rad is the Prince Rad now, who is created a trust and for the collection. The collection is very, very large, actually, and the modern art museum in Istanbul has several pieces for her work. These are from the more recent period in the 80s, and they're portraits of friends of hers. This is Khalid Shuman, who was a patron of the art, and this is Queen Zeyna, also from the Hashemite royal family. The reason I actually inserted this here, because I wanted to show the difference in her work between this kind of work, and look at the rounded eyes, and exaggerated eyes here, and this work in the 40s, and this work, which clearly this dress is the part of the traditional costume of Jordan. So she's truly adopted a reflection on the fact that she considers herself Jordanian and adopted the dress of Jordan. This is, many of you may have seen this image of a self-portrait by Salwa Raudash-Air, one of the first abstract artists from Lebanon. And she recently had a solo retrospective at the Tate Modern in London. So this is quite an honor for her, but a little bit late honor. She's now frail. Her health is, I'm not sure if she's still alive even. I think she is in love because she's close to 90 years old now. And it's a beautiful painting and was done in the 1940s of herself. She later went, after she did this painting in the 46, I think she went to study in Paris, like did independent study. She didn't join an academy or anything. Now, this is another example of going back in time to 44 to Van Leo, who is a well-known photographer from Egypt. So these are also portraits, and that's important to consider the introduction of photography in the region and the many influences it had on portraiture. So we're going to get back to this later on in the contemporary, because that's the period we're focusing on this evening. So do you have any questions so far on this? So does this make sense, going through time on this period? Clearly, we, as I said, for references to different periods and eras and genre of work, it's it might help to go to refer to the timeline of art history, because there are also examples and bios on each one of these artists and their influences. And that gives you the context, because we can't go over that in this one class. This is an artist that I'd like to explore further. Her name is Ghazabiya Sirri, and she's Egyptian. She taught art at the American University of Cairo for many years, and I think she recently donated her large collection to the university. She doesn't claim to be a feminist artist, but she takes on many subjects related to the position of women in Egypt, especially during that period, which I think is in the, for some reason I can't read the dates, but I think in the 50s, yeah. This is 1952, and that's a significant year for Egypt. That's the start of the revolution against the royalty, and King Farouk was deposed during that year. So here we can see that both mother and daughter, the door is locked. I mean, there is an emphasis on the lock at the door, and we notice also that in many of her works, the woman takes a frontal view and an empowered stance, compared to the male here, for example, in this picture. It's also the hands are enlarged, and that's significant, because it shows that the women are the ones who are sustaining the home, and they're the ones who actually are working, because many of the women in Egypt work, actually, and work either as peasants or have jobs, daily jobs, and they're part of the building of the new Egypt in 1950s, so that's also a reference to that. But they're also looking directly at the viewer in a challenging look as well. So it's she is empowering women definitely in this. But the bed, the frame of the bed is also significant, that it looks like as if they are, although they are seem like as if they're imprisoned in the home, yet they still have the power and the ability to work and sustain the home. So there is some contradiction here in this painting, and but in this one it is very clear where the woman stands in relation to the male, and so there are many gender references in her work during that period. And even in later period, you will see the frame, when her work became more abstract expressionist, and later on, it definitely clearly, there is always the image of a woman there in the background. Others who were known for their portraiture, although this is a group of fishermen here, is by Hamid Awais, also from the same period, he's Egyptian. But I referred earlier to your question also in what's happening in Egypt, in Iraq or other countries aside from Egypt. Everyone here may be familiar with Jawad Salim, his foremost painter, sculptor actually, in Iraq. He died at a young age. And this is a very well-known piece of his work, young men and women. This typical also of the way he painted the eyes. And if we look at archaeological findings in Iraq from the Sumerian period, we see similar depictions of these eyes and the neck. I love this piece. I think it's one of his. And you will see later on that other artists, Faiq Hassan, also has a work that also is inspired by these same features. I put in Fatih al-Mudarris example because you don't see portraits by Fatih very much. As you know, his work is more abstract and deals with the cities and with women, but in a more abstracted way. His work has been exhibited in Dubai many times, and but this is a rare piece from the 1960s. The image of woman and always seems to be featured in many of the posters during the revolutions, whether in the past revolutions like the Palestinian Revolution of the 1960s and the PLO posters. Like this one. Or in the Algerian Revolution, where women were at the forefront of the revolution, and after independence, they were given a back seat, and they were not awarded all the promises of independence and equal wage in Algeria. But again, this is a condition that Muna Hatoum picks up on, and we'll talk about it when we look at her work in a minute. Abdelhadi al-Ghazar is sort of, his work is surrealist in a way, and he is known to have these disfigured faces and almost unreal, mysterious types, and always surrounded with magical symbols. Which is, you see in many other also Egyptian artists' work, reference to magic symbols or some kind of patterns in the background. This is one of several in a series. I'm looking here at these disfigured faces, but this reminded me of Marwan Qassab Bashi. He is a Syrian artist who lives in Germany and has his work actually goes and auctions at very high prices. He was one of those Arab artists whose prices were up ever since the probably 80s. So this was not a big jump for him like other artists who were not known at that time. Sliman Mansour, in these paintings, he tried to show anxiety of Palestinians, the loss and the victimhood in his work. Yet there is determination at the same time. So there are two works here, both are self-portraits by him. One in 68, and that is right after the Six-Day War and the loss of the rest of Palestine proper. And the other one is 96, with him as an older man. Very interesting, comparisons. Muhannad Durra, I think this is Muhannad Durra, and sorry, his name is not there. This is an artist who is considered the foremost painter in Jordan, and the one who established several schools and was a tutor to many of the artists, the first artists in Amman. That's prior to Fakhr al-Nisr arrival to Jordan. So this is one, and he's known for his portrait of clowns. He even painted himself in a clown form. I was looking for artists who have done some self-portraits, so I put them, grouped them here together. That's why it is not necessary in a chronological order. So even this piece here by Samia Halabi is entitled Self-Portrait. So here you go. So in 1972, that's her work is very different in some ways from what she's doing right now with the computers. That's a beautiful piece, and I'm not sure if it's been exhibited at her retrospect or solo show at the YAM Gallery. But similar work was from that period. Another self-portrait here is by Shaker Hassan Al-Said, who is considered a philosopher of the Arab artist. He's from Iraq. And his interpretation and his work is a sort of verge on the existentialist, and his theories are quite of the unconscious, and his work is definitely not what you see here. It's more very abstract. It's similar to tapis almost work. And he started not a movement, but sort of a philosophy of art called Al-Ba'd Al-Wahid, the one dimension, in the 1960s. So, but this is typical of a self-portrait. Another self-portrait is by Jinan El-Basho, who is a Lebanese artist. And this was done during the war in Lebanon, as you can see, in 1985. She drew, this is actually a collage of photographs and using a copier machine. And her photograph here is on a divided Beirut. It's literally what you can, means what it shows here in the city, the map of the city of Beirut, and the divide of, because part of her family lived on one side, she was on the other side, and she was physically injured during the war. A bomb fell on her apartment and affected her health during that time. And so as a result, she did this work in 1985. This work is in a form of, later on she used it in the form of a book, artist book. So this became the one cover on the first page in an artist book that told the story, her personal story with the civil war in Lebanon. This is an image that was on a billboard in the underground in London for several months, and it was produced by, as you see, Muna Hatoum in 1988. This is the kind of work that I'd like to dwell on. Basically, you've got the background, a little bit of it. The rest will be on the timeline. Now we're going to focus on the contemporary artists. And this work in particular, we can see the image profile of Muna Hatoum herself, and she is confronting a toy soldier right squarely in the face. She's looking at him as if he's a fly sitting on her nose, or a mosquito, but it's not really affecting her. And so it's a defiant look. And what interests me in this, and the reason I selected this for the lecture today, is the significance of this work in relation to what's happening now and by soldiers in the Arab world. And what this work that she has done in 1988, as if Muna is great at understanding the undercurrents of what the politics of this region is and how its impact on the human being. So this clearly is not necessarily only about the soldiers from this part of the world, but she's referring to all soldiers everywhere. But what's important also about this is that she is looking here, referencing the women's persecution and violation of women in conflict times or during the wars. And if you take into consideration now what's happening in Syria and Iraq, this is really a poignant example of and representation by Muna. What is also important here to note, and I referred to a little bit earlier, is that she uses her body as the ground on which the soldier is. And that is at times, in many ways, the first Gulf War in Iraq, the Americans came in to save the women of Iraq and offer them liberation. And that was one of the reasons they gave, the persecution of women in a patriarchal society, and the Americans came to liberate the Arab women of Iraq. Similar to what happened in Algeria, actually, the French did not allow the Algerian woman to wear a scarf or a veil. That was forbidden during the French rule of Algeria. And that was in the name of emancipation, yet at the same time, the Algerians were persecuted. Very ironic. And so it becomes where the body of the woman is a metaphor for the battleground for these policies. And at the same time, when we think of the violation of women, of minority women, especially in Iraq, like the Yazidi women and other minorities, what's happening now by soldiers of the ISIL or Daesh or others, is very much what Muna is talking about here in 1988. So in her work, she is alluding to the trauma of women. But the woman here is not subservient to the soldiers and is looking at the soldiers squarely, as I said, in the face. And that is really important. And that's part of her genius of who I believe of Umana Hatoum is her ability to conceptualize, and not necessarily to foresee this, but this was there, but maybe not at the surface for us. But also there was a military rule in a way in several Arab countries during that period and other countries around the world. But it's the first people who are in these conflict who are violated are the women. And they are violated for a reason. So there's violation of women comes first, and then there is control. So many hundreds and thousands of inhabitants of Syria have fled because they worry about and what's going to happen to their daughters and their wives. So take that into consideration and consider this work. So then we go to Dia Azawi here. Again, he has the image of a woman, and this is for yet some romantic. So this is another artist who's looking back into literature and looking at poetry and Majnun Layla, which is a temptation. So inspired by poetry, and he has many works, Dia Azawi, that is inspired either by Mahmoud Darwish or Adonis or others. So we got these were the different kinds of work that were being produced almost around the same time. So we have Dia Azawi living in London doing this work, Muna Hatoum living in London doing this other work. Okay, so and I'm trying to focus here on faces and portraits in this presentation, and see how each one of these artists dealt with this subject. The next example is by a British Iraqi artist. I think her mother is British or Irish, and her father is Iraqi. Many of you may have seen her work here, Jinan Elani. I think she was a couple of years ago. Jinan was represented at Art Dubai. Here again, we have Jinan Elani looking back at 19th century European references to the female body as a contested territory in the colonialist project. And she brings back this back in a different way than Muna. Here, it is not just her, it's her whole family, her mother and the sister. So it's the female in their family that are represented in a series of photographs. And these are very large photographs. And we can see them covered, partly covered, and then revealed, and so on, in grades, I mean. And then there is a focus on their faces and the full body. So this was also, I think, in 19... in the 1990s. Yes. So in the 1990s, Jinan Al-Ani became interested also in the same subject I referred to earlier about the veil and the Algerian woman. And she actually later on was one of the curators of the exhibition The Veil and the publication with the same title. A very interesting and very well done exhibition at that time. If I remember, it was maybe around, I can't remember the year, but you can Google it, you'll find. And in that, she was exploring this notion of the veil and the Western understanding or stereotype of Arab women when the veil is in the way. Another example also around the same time are the faces by, for example, Adel Siwi, who exhibited in Venice a few years back his work. And this is really typical. No one does these faces except Adel Siwi. Similar to Marwan Qassab-Lashi, it's a signature work of these distorted faces. And when he, for a couple of years, he led a workshop in Jordan at Darat al-Funun, and now you can see many of those students who took that workshop, their early work was similar to his work, so we call them Qassab Bashi's children. So some of the artists stick to one style, and if it sells, they continue working on that style, or they're more interested in it, and they expand on it. This is an amazing work by Saad Al-Attar, an Iraqi artist who is living now in London for many years. Its title is very telling, Cry from Mesopotamia in 2004, right after the first invasion and after her sister was actually killed during one of the bombardments of during the Clinton administration, actually, in 1994. Or 1993, a plane bombed her home, and her sister was living in that home. And her sister died, and her husband, and that affected her, actually, for many years. And her mother was, home was also damaged. So it was a really sad situation. Portraits of important intellectuals, Arab and other, are on murals everywhere, and it's interesting to find this mural at the San Francisco State University. It was initiated by a group of Arab students there. So portraits represent many things. It's not just the personality, but also this pride the students had in the work of Edward Said, and they wanted to celebrate it in an American university on campus, and still there today. And that's, I think, from late 1990s. Others, Shand Avizian, many of you will probably have seen his work. It's probably at every, very, very popular with collectors in the region because he relies on iconic images like Jamal Abdel Nasser and Umm Kulthum and others, then the rest is decoration. So this is really what sells now in the Arab world, is a familiar faces sell. And he's also a great good artist. That's important. One artist that I'm not sure you're familiar with is the Syrian artist Khalid Takrit. I think now he's represented by a YAM gallery. They have a great group of Syrian artists. And I thought this was an interesting portrait. I'm not going to go into more detail about it because we don't have that much time left. So the stereotype of woman is used both ways. Some artists believe that when they present women in the image of this stereotype, that they are challenging the West. But at the same time, others critique that methodology of presentation, such as Layla Sayed's work, for example. She believes that because she is tackling this issue head on in this her work, this portrayal is trying to critique the Western gaze on of the Arab woman and the veiling and all that. But these are the, again, these are the kind of portrait that actually sell in the region. They're very popular for, it'd be interesting to know for what specific reasons they are so popular. But again, we critique the Orientalist look of the Orientalist artist and what their impressions of the Orient. But at the same time, we imitate them and present these kinds of work where the Arabic writing becomes the, makes the work even more exotic. But again, there is two points of view about this. Living in the West, much of this artwork is very popular, and it will attract curators and collectors, actually. This kind of work also is quite popular. This was one of the earliest works in the that dealt with the veil, but it wasn't meant to look at it from a feminist point of view. Actually, Leila Shawa is from Gaza, and when she did this work, it was done in relation to what's happening to the Gaza people who were surrounded, imprisoned, actually. And this was done in 1992, and that's before the discourse on the veil became so common or upfront. And as you can see, they can't reach their ice creams, or their ice cream is melting. It's very literal, actually. Others who took off, I mean, clearly this is the work many of you may know already know by Ingres, the Odalisk from the 19th century. And this is Helen Zoghaib. She's a Lebanese artist who lives in Washington, D.C. And this is after Mondrian, again. Other artists who have actually mined archives of photography to introduce the portraits, such as, and these are, we're talking literally hundreds of portraits that were identified by Akram Zaatari in the holdings of photographers, Lebanese photographers. So this, we're not talking about the imagined, but the actual real document archives of photography. And this is an exhibition that was in New York at the Gray Art Gallery at NYU with the images, the portraits. They're not actually portraits, they're passport photographs that were in the collection on the archive of this photographer who had a studio in Beirut. And many of these photographs, along with other archival photographs, are now in the collection of the Arab Image Foundation, which is over 10-year-old institution in Beirut that gathers and conserves photographs of the from the region, from Egypt, from all over. And it will be interesting to look at the portraits within that, but that is a whole lecture by itself, is analyzing and exploring the photographs or the portraits within that collection and how people, portrayed themselves across different decades. You could see even men dressed up as women. This all takes place in the studios, and during that period, it seems like there was it was popular for young people to just go to the studio, dress up as cowboys or show off as boxers and pose in different poses. As you can see, well, these are real, I think, ones, but sometimes they are staged. Most of the time they are. And the Arab Image Foundation have organized many exhibits on these collections. That this is one of them. These are all passport photographs that were taken by this photographer. So I find this very interesting. And I put this here for you as a source and not necessarily as an example from that peer, because that in itself has layers and layers of interesting topics and themes that one can mine within this. And that's why the value of this Arab Image Foundation, because they offer a space for researchers to actually go through the collection. And most of it is online now, so you could go and check that for yourself. I just wanted to mention it here through the work of Raad and Akram Zaatari. Now, clearly, I wanted to focus in this lecture, as I said, on portraits. Their photography has is a huge subject, and we can't go into now, but I want to introduce you to this artist. I'm not sure anyone knows Yasser Agur. Anyone have seen his work before? No one. Okay. Yasser is an Egyptian artist who studied in the United States and ended up teaching and living there at Syracuse University in New York. And he's a multimedia. He uses all kinds of media depending on the topic he's working on. This particular work is called Litigation, I think, Ligature Series. And Ligature Series. And this work is a comment on the outsourcing. And during this work was done early 2000, and many companies in the United States and Europe also outsourced work to China, to India, as you know now. It's very common. In those days, it was sort of the beginning of this. And so he wanted to critique that in his own way. So what he did, he commissioned painters of these billboards in Egypt, the ones who paint the advertisements for the movies and other advertisements. He sent them photographs of these personalities and asked them to paint them. Then he shipped the paintings to New York, where he photographed them and then manipulated them on the digital, digitally manipulated them, changing, of course, the background and the color, and then photographed them and presented them in this exhibition to investigate this idea of the outsourcing. So he, as an artist, outsourced another artist in Egypt. And that was the process. And the result was a fantastic production of the images of these personalities. And it's interesting, and as you see more of his work, you'll see why there is humor in his work as well for the selection of this work. This is another work that he has done, and it's called Pope One in 2003. Again, I mean, it's very clear what it is about. And when I saw this work for Muhammad Kano, it somehow reminded me of Yasser Agur's work, but it's also interesting that sometimes you want to see the personalities, infamous personalities, the way you want to see them. And that's what Muhammad Kano decided to do with this. So we have Obama here, as if he just came out from the mosque in Dubai. So this is one way what the artists have now able to use is the digital manipulation of these photographs in many different ways. And now there's also 3D and all that. So different dimensions of images. So another example is, and he is very, very popular in Dubai. Halim Karim is work here is portrays always faces out of focus. So it gives a sort of a sense of anxiety mixed with mystery and creates a sort of a tension with the viewer because we're not sure who these people are. And this is not a portrait in the sense that there is a subject in there that you can identify with. So you can't identify with these people, and this way he creates that kind of attention. And very attractive, clearly. This is on the cover of a book I co-edited, so clearly the publisher chose it because it is so attractive in color. I want to go back to Agur again because he has another interesting work, which several contemporary artists have dealt with different ways of presenting the subject in relation to race or gender. Cindy Sherman is one of those artists who did that. And you will see what I mean by this, because here is Yasser Agur again, presenting himself as an American me, but he saw him in a female image. So again, it's a photograph plus manipulation of that photograph, but this is only the portrait. Yet he also did a performance of this. And so there is a performativity in his work, such as here in his, he dressed up sort of like a punk. I mean, he looked really, is not the kind of person you want to sit next to on an airplane. And this is a performance that actually took place on an airplane. And you can see there's nobody sitting next to him. And so when I asked him, why you want to put yourself in such a situation? Well, that was 2004. The security wasn't yet as probably security would let him through today. But for him, it was an impersonation. I mean, his subject and looking at himself in another character, practically. So in a way, also, he is critiquing societal norms by doing that, photographing himself as a woman and then as a punk and then in Paris, walking the streets of Paris in a Michelin tires outfit. So it's a performance and a conceptual art of sorts that he attracts audiences. He also, in his work, borrows images from websites anywhere and manipulates them and creates these new imagery. There he is again with another type of character. So he would dress up like a terrorist and has dinner with his family and photographs himself and the reaction and how the photography gives a presentation, a different kind of presentation. This is a very interesting work. I have only one photo of this series of work called The Hunted. And here what he does, he takes photographs, existing photographs of hunters with their prey, captured prey. And he eliminates the hunter from the picture. And what remains facing the viewer is a confrontation of mortality with this animal, actually, that is at its last breath. But we kind of know there is a hunter. So generally, the hunter is standing next to the trophy. And in this case, he takes that away. And we are confronted with this solitude of mortality at this last moment. In this lifeless, almost animal, and yet many of the photographs, they're already dead corpses. So what does this tell us? I mean, what does it represent? It represents nature, it represents destruction, it represents sort of violence and beauty at the same time. So it does have the aesthetics, but it's a violent aesthetics. And it also looks at the idea of this hunting for as a sport. So that's, again, a societal norm that he is critiquing in this kind of work. Another artist who actually works almost in this vein, and you may know him, he's been exhibited here, I think, and is a Moroccan, I think, artist. So we don't have the time to go over him, but if you're interested, you can jot his name and look at him later. Durar Bakri is another self-portrait of an artist, and here he is with his own self-portrait. I wanted to show Palestinian artists from Ramallah how they envision themselves. And I think this is really disturbed. It looks like somebody who's anguished and going through the occupation and what's happening in Ramallah. Many of the artists want to reflect that in their work. It's living within that situation. Raed Bouaye is a photographer, and these are portraits. And there are many Palestinians who are using photography in their work, and other Arab artists actually. So I try to focus on those who are focusing either on the portrait itself or any relationship to that. Mahmoud Arabi self-portrait. Here's another one, self-portrait, and the very famous Kalthum by George Bahajouri, his work is full of humor. And actually, he has a huge number of series of faces either of important people, just people he knows, but they're more caricaturish style. So you could actually include in portraiture the caricatures, because there are many of them who use that kind of thing. A beautiful, looking at beauty again, this is a beautiful work by Hassan Fathi. It's called The New Gurna in Upper Egypt. Now, he is Nubian, that's the reference here to Upper Egypt. And he's always referring back to the demise of the Nubian after the building of the Aswan Dam and, as you know, Lake Nasser flooded the original home of the Nubians. And that's, he kind of references that a great deal. But here he wanted to show a proud Nubian. And he lives actually in Italy, not far from Venice, a wonderful artist. And I'm not sure if his work has been shown in Dubai. I don't think so, right. But he's exhibited all over, and I wanted to show this because he has several portraits of this, and himself also self-portraits. But this is very typical of his work, his beautiful color combination. Another one who has actually worked on the portrait of the Fidai and the Kafiye is Baalbaki, Ayman Baalbaki, and I think you all know him so well, so I'm not going to dwell very much on him, but that brings us closer to artists from the region. Here is Lamia Gargash. She's represented by Third Line Gallery, not far from here, and this is, I think, her first solo exhibit at the gallery where she, you know, many people by nature, many people always feel there is one part of their face or feature that is, they look in the mirror and they really see themselves, that feature exaggerated. People go around thinking they have a big nose and they need $1,000 worth of plastic surgery to reconstruct their noses, or they think they have long ears, or so she wanted to investigate that. And so she hired an artist who actually created these kind of the so-called deformities in the faces of the subjects. And so here is Rosie, always thought that she has small eyes. So she actually interviewed or knows several people who consider that they have some kind of an exaggerated feature in their face. And then over a series of many sittings, they had this cosmetic specialist do the makeup, the special makeup. It's almost like what they do in Hollywood when they change the features of the face. Here's another person, Manny, who believed that he had a large forehead, larger than what it is. So that was emphasized. So there was the photo of himself and the photo of the exaggerated. The photos were beautifully reproduced in an exhibition, and there were at least 12, I think, subjects that were treated. Some thought their their ears were long, so they had very elongated earlobes. That was a work of art, just to create this earlobe without detaching, and just a very long earlobe, you know, with an earring at the end. So that seemed, I thought that was an interesting work. This work is by an artist from Qatar, Sofia Al-Maria, and it's the Sci-Fi Wahhabi number 4. She has a series of these works critiquing conservative, Wahhabi, those who believe in Wahhabi and are at the same time very conservative and looking at the veil and the issue of the veil. I mean, it's very interesting because here she focuses on what she says, a person that seems like it's wearing all black, but you see only the kohl eyes, but you don't see the rest. So you can, it's as if saying, impose on me what you think is the rest. And so she has a critique of this that is very interesting. So I thought I would include it here, although it's not a self-portrait of her, but it is a portrait of what she sees in the others. And she sees this kind, characterizes it as a sci-fi type of imagery. Clearly it is here. The other artist I like to go a bit more detail about is an artist who considers herself a feminist artist, and she explores the theme as it relates to the Western gaze and how she, in a very personal manner, responds to the common stereotype of Arab and Muslim women in the West. And this is the work first. So this is the work called Silent Virgin Mary 2000, and it's a self-portrait, and you can see it's, you can barely actually see the image, but you could, it could possibly be the Virgin Mary from the back, or it's a veiled woman. So that again is a comment on critiquing the stereotype of the West has of any woman wearing a veil by doing this kind of comparison. She did another work that on the same theme called Silent Sight, and here it is clearly about the gaze, and what this is a 10-minute video whereby she uses a voiceover, and you listen to it, this voice narrating very slowly as a witness, narrating an intimate conversation, actually story about reflecting on the gaze. And the video and the voice recounts the impressions of travel, her own family. As I said, her reflections in her art are always personal. It's either about her or her family members. And here she talks about the travels of her mother between Paris, where she was born, and Algeria. And then it talks about her mother stating things like, when I come to Algeria, I pick up the scarf, my scarf, and I cover my hair. When I go back to Paris, I put it back in the bag. And so talking about life in as an immigrant in France and life in Algeria. It is a very interesting work, again, on the gaze. Another work that is of relevance here, because it portrays a family again. It looks at the relationship between, here you see Sadira Zainab with her mother, and then you see her daughter with the grandmother, and you see her with her daughter. So it's three generations here. And so it's called Daughter and I, clearly. And looking at them, but also here looking at their story, because the Zainab's daughter doesn't speak Arabic. So, and the grandmother speaks only Arabic, and she doesn't speak English or French. So what happens is that the daughter, who grew up between Paris and London, speaks English and French with her mother, but she and Zainab speaks Arabic with her mother. So, but this kind of a generation now that we have to deal with, where your own granddaughter, you cannot converse with you because of that language barrier. And so it's again called a grandmother and granddaughter Algeria, and then it's a three-screen installation, so you could hear the conversations going, if you know, and in how it's a very interesting comment on that. So it's sort of a portrait of a family. Then think about it that way. And closer to home here is there's a work by Manal Duayan, who's a Saudi Arabian artist. Anyone has knows Manal? Yeah, many are familiar with her work. She is actually represented by Quadro Gallery in the IFC. And I mean, she definitely references many gender politics issues, and her themes are very closely related to that topic, particularly in this work I chose here, where she you have a woman clearly from this region, and the writing says ignorance is it relates to the idea that it's ignorance that is forbidding women from gaining their full independence and the human rights in some countries. Where here is another photograph. I mean, you can just read in the title ideas. I am a filmmaker here, a filmmaker in control, but actually not in control. again, it's the same here. The choice, I mean, it's very literal, practically. This is the choice I have to drive, but I can't drive. So there's a lot of contradictions here. Ibtissam Abdelaziz looks at work differently. I mean, she's an Emirati artist, and she's also represented by Third Line Gallery and had several solo shows there already. And she's a prominent artist in the UAE, leading artist, actually, from what we could say the second generation of artists in the UAE. And this is a series of photographs and sort of brain scan images at the top. And she actually, there was a, she's both, she's very prolific. She does, she paints, she does installations, she works in multimedia of all sorts, and is also one of the first women I know from the UAE who does performance art. So that's also important. But I included this for clear reasons, for this kind of repetition of the face and more than anything else. Another artist here, in Emirati artist, who has done actually a large series of works on portraiture, more like sketches in caricature style, is Mohammed Al-Mazrui. And he had recently exhibited in the last Emirati Expression in 2013, last year, that was actually organized by TCA and Banarat Saadiyat. And there was a whole wall of these portraits that he did, a sketch of portraits. And then on the side also there were sort of caricaturish type portraits that could be the silhouette of Jesus Christ and the woman, some of them in different kind of positions, very revealing. It was very interesting to have such an exhibit, actually a whole room of these kinds of portraits. Some of them were sketched similar to this one, but without the ink on top. So that gives you sort of an idea of his work. So it's less than this, it's more like this now recently. Another artist who does portraits is Fatima Al-Mazrui, and I saw this work for her, which interests me because of the writing that was superimposed on several, not every image, but several of these images. Words such as hurriya, freedom, and similar words, also again, gender politics themes and others. Collage is very popular among several Emirati artists. This one, Hamdan Shamsi, says IU is again a collage of a female figure. Jalal Luqman is well known here, and many of you may already have seen his work. He works in digital art, and this is computer art, actually. And his wife also, Sumaya Swedi, does similar work in computer digital art. And most of the time, her work to me seems like sci-fi, actually. Science fiction type of images that just are unreal. And so it's not the same, similar to her husband in some way. Karima Shomali, who's currently studying her PhD in England, has done also a series of work on you could explain it different way, either censorship or inability of women to, you know, speak for herself. And so she has these faces of women with their mouth taped. I think it's her face and face of others, people with her. Salama Al-Mazrui is a realistic painter, as you can see. She's done this work for Sheikh. And there another artist who's done an exquisite realistic portrait like this is Fatima Al-Mazrui also. And she's represented, I think, by Salwa Zaidan's gallery. And the artist I referred to earlier with her use of color in the shaping of the portrait is Noor Iswedi. I mean, she's an excellent artist and does a fantastic job in portraying these images of mostly women, actually. I haven't seen most of her work is images of women like this one. And she's also represented by Quadro Gallery, and many of you may have seen this series. Was exhibited only last year. Sold out, actually. And there's another one with a portraiture. We call this portrait, clearly. It's typical of that and her work. Again, here, the use of, it's all in pastel colors. So basically, these are the examples I have brought you today, but I'm happy to show you more if you're interested and discuss more of any of the topics we covered today.